Attention. Movie guys love movies. Any comments about anyone complaining that there isn't enough originality in movies these days are purely for entertainment purposes only. And they should probably just shut up. Isn't that right, Hardcore Henry?
So that's a shout out to the curmudgeons. There aren't any new movies around.
Oh, I know.
Everything's a superhero movie.
They're always there for like a superhero movie. They never come out of the woodwork when a movie's truly original like this and then go, oh, hey, sorry. Sorry to mention it, but this is really original. Nah, there were other complaints. I don't like these curmudgeons.
I remember when it was that music video, right? The band, what were they called? Biting Elbows. Was
Biting Elbows.
And they put out that video that was all first person. It's 36 million hits on YouTube or
amazing.
Something.
Amazing.
And now movie. Yeah. And I think it's the same guys, the same team, sort of saw it to feature length with a Kickstarter, I guess. Although, I think your Kickstarter is 36 million hits with ad revenue from YouTube. But if they needed more money, I think they raised it, and now we have this film.
Yeah, producer Timur Bekmambetov.
Did he produce this?
One of the more fun names to say. Oh, I wanted to do hockey player or production member on this movie. I forgot to write that.
Who would know?
Bit.
This is very Blair Witch. That took me a little bit to get used to. I don't know if I'm going to be able to. I definitely, if I see this, I cannot sit in the first.
Did you say stomach
half,
it?
Yeah, cause I almost literally, said stomach it. Because I have to sit like in the back row for stuff like this. Right. I need to be far away.
We moved back during Hunger Games. You want to move back three or four rows.
I have trouble seeing what I'm looking at.
That was here's something only a movie guy would say. That was uncharacteristically shaky cam for Gary Ross. But it was.
You said something like that. We were way back from the Comic-Con, and I had bought the Krull soundtrack to honor James Horner.
Hey, this Horner score sounds pretty Sylvester.
I know. And when you're hanging out with Paul and I and the references can fly like that, he apologizes the rest of the car first, and he goes, this is going to be a bit of a movie guy's thing I'm going to say here. This James Horner score sounds very Alan Silvestri.
You can tune up. Then you can please come back to us after.
All right, we're back. Yeah. Everybody back in the pool.
Hey, welcome to the Movie Showcast, everybody. Part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys empire. And we're also president of Spatula City. We like Spatula so much, we bought the company.
Great.
You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with rants, sketches, previews, characters, jokes, bits, banter, special guests, and more. You can expect that in the next hour or so as we broadcast from the Admiral's Club in the heart of Burbank Airport's flyover zone. If you're new to the Power of the Movie Showcast, we'll be here every week with movie previews, prepping you for the big weekend at the multiplex, spoiler-free and cost-free, as the whole program costs you, the listener, absolutely.
You know, Paul, I got a disturbing phone call today from my bank, and it turns out I've maxed out my credit card, so I will not be able to pay for anything this evening.
Oh, hey, Bart, fear not.
Yes?
This show has no cost.
Well, good. Well, then please continue.
Yeah, exactly. All right. You've run your credit limit to the max, you can still enjoy the movie.
Trust me, it was purely an accounting error. I have the funds, the check's in the mail, I'm solvent, please don't send money.
Gotcha.
I'm good.
Bart at themovieguys.net, just in case you want to send something. Let's see. We encourage you to follow us on social media, at The Movie Guys, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, which is also free, and get interactive. So, you know, yell at us for saying things about
Bart,
Alan
don't
Sylvester.
Don't worry about it. You can go on Instagram, too.
Oh, okay.
And you don't even have to have any.
I can't get my phone into the card, the slot. I have a 4S, so apparently you can't get the credit card into the phone anymore.
Here's what we're saying. Podcasts are a horrible business model.
Yeah.
That's what we're saying. Basically, search The Movie Guys on Yahoo, Bing, or
Google.
And we come right up. I'm your host for the hardest working comedy show in the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Adam Witt.
I don't know. Fly casual.
Karen Volpe?
It's a sweater!
Nice. And Bart Caius.
I'm sorry, is the Colonel's underwear a matter of national security?
Joining us later in the show for our guest segment, it's going to be a good one, as we have in studio a regular on TV shows like The Drew Carey Show, Norm, Felicity, and Cougar Town. Also appeared in films like My Big Fat Greek Wedding and its sequel, which is now in theaters. Not to mention his new film, Always Worthy, now available on iTunes, Amazon Prime, and many other on-demand platforms. Ian Gomez will be here. Shouting from the green
room. And I want to talk to that Ian Gomez about that Cougar Town.
Okay.
Because I have a feeling about that show, because I came into it many, many seasons into it, and I don't think that's what it started out to be. It started out to be something very, very different.
Oh, really?
And then it became this amazingly charming, hilarious, half-hour, very tidy little sitcom. Because I think it started as somewhat salacious. Like, we might see Courtney Cox's boobs, maybe not. We're
like
hoping. I mean, that was the hope
Everyone
every episode.
Hopes that.
That was the hope every episode.
Gosh, I hope that just in life.
For me, yes. Yeah. That was my hope.
If I go to the Ralphs, I'm hoping if I see her, I might see her boobs.
And then I shifted to hoping to see Ian Gomez's boobs.
Hey, that might happen tonight.
It happened all the time on that trip. Which is why I kept.
That's true.
By the way, Ian,
I've written it down. Okay.
You shouted, yay me. But if you hear a good joke here, you feel free to shout out, yay joke. That would work too. Just
I'm laughing as loud as I can. I'm not mic'd yet.
Oh, he's like presuming he'll be mic'd later. This week's movies offer something for everyone. Hardcore Henry and the Boss. Wildly different films, yet both committed to being released with their ready-to-go porn parody title already in place.
My name is Michelle Darnell, and I am the wealthiest woman in America. How wealthy am I? I wanted to come down on a golden phoenix, and I sure as shit did it.
Well, there you go.
I love that. That makes me so happy. I don't even understand why I can't.
She is literally the funniest person working in movies.
She's really funny.
Hands down, gender, weight, height. With anything.
Box office.
I just
she's
want
the funniest person I want to see.
I just want her to be your best friend.
I
want
to pull that off, Karen.
I'm going to work on it.
You're pretty charming.
She was on Stern and she was very cool. One thing I really related to is she was talking about her upbringing and the fact that she just lived in the middle of the country, couldn't ride her bike to her friend's house, had no choice but to entertain herself. I know that.
And the farm animals,
right? And the farm animals, which I did that too. I would sing to the cows because there were no kids near me.
Did you really go out to the
pasture? Oh, I really did.
And sing to the cows.
Yeah, and what I would do, because we had this huge, because there was nothing to do, dude. I am not kidding. So we had this giant garden. And so in the fall, it was, you know, when you're ready to harvest, I would take a thing of cabbage, giant cabbage head, about almost the size of a basketball. And I would just stand there and sing, and the cows would hear me, and I would just peel the cabbage and then feed them. And it was all.
It's such a metaphor for Hollywood and money and cabbage, and the herd is coming to you.
Keeping your audience.
This is amazing.
I really knew my audience then.
Wow, culling the herd, feeding them cabbage.
Chewing with your mouth open.
Yeah. And then when my dad yelled at me for wasting food, when does that happen?
Oh,
okay.
In the third act.
Well, no, when the ingenue goes to the bathroom and throws up the meal she was just bought.
Perfect.
That's the analogy there.
Yeah.
We got to upgrade the tech on this show because I wanted to do first person cameras. That would have been fun, right? For Hardcore Henry.
Sure.
We all have a camera tied to our head.
You got any duct tape? We'll stick your phone to your head.
That's the problem. We all went around the room. Who's got enough space on their phone? Nobody's got enough space.
No, that's what Paul meant when he said he wants to elevate the production. We don't have duct tape.
Yeah, that's right.
We need money for duct tape.
There you go. Yeah, but it's us again. The show is free.
Yeah.
We could have stuck him to our heads and just not recorded because, yeah, mine's all. I buy the cheapest one, so it's like.
That's true.
Which is amazing. Like, my phone only holds 16 gigs, 16 times the amount of information that sent us to the moon. And I've
hey,
got it
no
packed
room.
Up with
not enough.
Shots of weird homeless people that I never tweet. I get around to it.
I'll put them in post. I'll put headphones on everybody.
Let me be the first to thank you for that. For not tweeting those.
Joke!
It wasn't hooray joke. It was just acknowledgement.
Just
I don't know what to make of it.
I feel like I'm in Del Close's class again, and we would be doing something, and he'd be way in the back in the dark, and if he liked it, he'd go, ah!
Not enough coughing, though.
All that Ian did was identify.
That's it!
I used to shoot heroin between my toes.
It's just like it.
It is.
No, all he did there was just identify that was a joke.
Yeah. Oh, yes. I see. He was naming. Yeah.
Pointing and saying joke.
In a moment, he'll just go, show!
Host! Yeah. All right, let's get on to our first big movie of the week. If there's one criticism that movies have suffered over and over, it's that they aren't enough like video games.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Here's a movie that's going to change that. It's Hardcore Henry. Adam, let's talk about it. Here we go.
Hardcore. Hard Henry. Core. Henry.
Let's see now. With a title like Hardcore Henry, as you can imagine, we are inspired to play another round of...
Guess What It's About!
Yes, Guess What It's About. So I put it to the table with the title Hardcore Henry. Hmm. What do you think this film is about? And please be a Henry Rollins documentary.
How about this? A pizza delivery guy named Henry that gets a tip of a lifetime when he delivers to a sorority house?
Let's see. Oh, not so much.
Hardcore.
Actually,
on.
Paul, it's a dad named Henry who is seduced by a barely legal... babysitter.
No.
Actually, I think it's The Night in the Life of a Guy Named Henry from West Hollywood.
No, you guys. No? As you are all... Wait, oh, you're what? All right, I guess. But let's see. Oh, those are indeed plots to a movie called Hardcore Henry. But this Hardcore Henry, it's actually on IMDb.
Oh.
Gotcha. Okay.
It is different. This is a story of a robotic super soldier.
Sold!
Who must fight a telekinetic albino supervillain.
Sold!
To stop his plot for world domination.
Sold!
So Adam, you're in this one.
I'm in.
Hardcore Henry is the first movie ever to be told from a first-person point of view, putting the audience in the middle of a hard-nosed fight to the death against an army that will stop at nothing.
What?
The best kind of army.
Yeah.
To stop you.
Just like in POV porn, they've removed the most distracting thing about the movie, the dude's face. And a cursory glance at the IMDb credits reveals that no character named Henry is listed, so apparently no actor was actually cast to play Henry. Oh, wait a second. Oh, here it is. Jessica L. Lopez, Steadicam operator.
Oh, there you go. The biggest reveal about Henry seems to be that he wears nerdy white tennis shoes. They look like they might be New Balance.
Are you Steve Jobs?
What?
Hold on a second. Are you the billionaire owner of Apple Computers?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, in that case, you got no right to wear New Balance sneakers ever.
Exactly not the type of shoe I would expect for a badass who's not Steve Jobs.
Henry wakes up not remembering much or being able to speak. And if that doesn't suck enough, before he can even take a healthy morning whiz, his insanely hot wife is kidnapped and is being shot at. Fearing for his life and very much wanting to have sex with his insanely hot wife, played by Haley Bennett, Henry decides to spring into action and figure it all out along the way.
The trailer is the equivalent of riding down a water slide. If that water slide took you through twists and turns of sex, murder, bionic legs, parachutes, motorcycles, and grenades, and landed you in a big splashy pool of whatever the hell.
Director Ilya Naishuller seems to be taking the genre of shaky cam to a whole new level. This feels more like monkey cam, actually.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think it's easy to see that this technology has limitless applications.
Monkey cam.
Second note. Ilya Naishuller. I was wondering what the Russians were doing when taking a break from laughing at the British actors who play them as villains in movies.
How the f*** did they do that? The movie looks like one of the... No, scratch that. The most visceral movie experience of all time. And by visceral, I mean it's going to make you puke.
Is this in 3D?
No, the theaters threatened to pass the upholstery cleaning bill onto the filmmakers if they release this in anything but 2D. To further explain...
Let me explain. No, there is too much. Let me sum up.
If you were worried that the relentless wall-to-wall action will impede character development, I ask you, why do you hate movies? If I said Spotlight didn't have enough car chases, shootouts, and explosions, would you take me seriously?
So the main question is, will gamers make it off their parents' basement couch to see this film? That's the question.
Wow.
If so, box office.
Speaking of gamers, I have decided that I am going to leave the sofa and go see this movie.
You're going to go see this?
Oh, really?
See this
in the theaters. Ian and I usually wait for things to come to me in the home.
Yeah, he watches it on TV.
But I'm actually going to take a remote control, gaming control, and pretend that I'm playing the movie. And see if anyone notices that I may or may not be controlling what's happening on screen.
This movie, if you hit up, up, down, down, left, right, A, B, start.
She gets naked.
Yeah.
She is the chick from Music and Lyrics.
Remember
the crazy sort of American Idol typey chick in that?
Oh, who remembers?
Have you seen Music and Lyrics?
No, but I have seen Brainstorm.
But you would be talking about her if you did.
I would be. You Brainstorm? Would.
From 1980?
Yes. Is that the one where the guy
with
has
Natalie Wood
puts the head
well, he has,
on?
He has sex with a woman.
Wait a second. I would like Bart to tie together Music and Lyrics and Brainstorm. Go.
Well,
you might be thinking of Videodrome, but that's very guys of me to say. Go ahead.
Music and Lyrics and Hardcore Henry is what I'm going to be tying together. And... Brainstorm.
Okay.
All at once. Watch, everyone.
Isn't Brainstorm...
And Penn and Teller, tell us how he did it.
Isn't Brainstorm the movie where they figure out a way to record people's thoughts and experiences?
Yeah.
And then you can play them back and you can experience Paul's thoughts and experiences as if you were Paul.
Yes. So it's all Richard Edlund. But anyway.
Or Strange Days.
Anyways, so back for movie guy talk.
So one of those guys figures out that I'm going to record myself having sex with a woman.
Okay.
And then I'm going to splice it into a loop and just orgasm all night. Doesn't that happen in Brainstorm?
I think that happens in Videodrome.
I'm pretty
Is it
sure.
Videodrome? I don't know.
That definitely.
Does James Woods get a VHS tape put in his stomach?
No.
Oh.
That definitely happened in Music and Lyrics. That and the fact
right?
that she had to water his plant.
Okay.
That happened.
Two plot points
mm-hmm.
from that movie.
So that's all I'm saying is that hopefully in Hardcore Henry there's that moment where he realizes, or that the audience gets to experience.
Oh, the POV sex
Haley
will
Bennett.
Happen.
Yes.
Right?
Gotta have POV sex.
This is what I'm getting at.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why the gamers are going.
Actually, that'll be kind of interesting for women because we usually don't know what the point of view of of having sex with a woman is.
It's amazing, Karen.
Oh, so that'll be interesting to see. Because we've only seen what's coming at us, and it's usually a dude.
And God love you for sticking around after you see that. Because every once in a while I'll catch myself in the mirror. I don't know how you people do it. I don't know how you do it. God love you and the work you're doing.
Like in Big Fat Greek Wedding 2, you just close your eyes.
Yeah, just.
Oh, is that the recommendation?
Oh my God, they're so funny. Yeah.
This is one of those impossible movies to make that's going to be impossible to pull off, and I think they're really going to do it. It's like, did you remember the movie The Raid? Where it's just one relentless action sequence after another. And if there's some movies like this where it's like, it's exploitation, you know, it's like, all right, we're taking this one idea, we're making this whole movie. But then the challenge is like, okay, well, how do you do variations on that? How do you keep that going? And where are we going next? But this movie looks like there's plenty of places to go. It's going to be exhausting.
And there really is no, I didn't see anybody cast as Henry. So I'm wondering if
on IMDb. Yeah, I don't think it's.
Yeah.
So that's really the woman that this woman.
Was figure out who the Steadicam operator was, I assume. And so I'm also guessing there is no moment where he turns to the mirror and we finally get to see what Henry looks like. Otherwise, there'd be a guy or a person, right?
They always do that, right? Strange Days or whatever. So. Yeah, you turn to the mirror and you see yourself or whatever.
So now I'm wondering if all the legs and arms and feet that we see, because in the trailer you see that much of him. Is it all just CGI? Is it all computered?
Oh, you think that's put in later, maybe?
Wonder. Yeah. Did they just run the camera through?
Depends on how much they want to accomplish.
I bet you they use computers in this movie, Adam. Wait a minute.
They computered that movie.
I'm feeling gypped.
See, all audience, right. This is what you get.
Karen, are we going?
No, oh, you are.
Okay,
sure.
Paul?
Absolutely.
Paul, you were just saying we don't see enough movies together.
That's true.
I believe Hardcore Henry.
Enjoy.
That might be one. Yeah. But next week, we're going to Jungle Book. That's
absolutely. Oh, my gosh. They've already started teasing some of the scenes. They had Bill Murray was on, Jimmy Kimmel.
Yep.
And he's saying a little bit of the Jungle Book with the
he's
Mowgli.
Baloo.
Oh, my God.
He's
so
Baloo.
Excited.
Far be it for me to get on a tangent about movies.
Yes.
But that movie is one of the few movies that can be remade. Because usually I think movies don't need to be remade unless there's a big advancement behind it. And this is it.
Well, live action is
that's what I'm
is
saying.
The
is
big
it?
Advancement
yeah.
for these things.
Because
now you can do all the effects and you can do a talking bear and all that stuff.
Exactly. Yeah, Planet of the Apes needed to be remade. We need better apes.
Yeah, we need better apes.
You know, this works because we can actually combine live action.
Yeah, it's like long-time classic things like Alice in Wonderland. They just keep remaking it, you know, and no one goes, what? They go, oh, this would be interesting. Yeah.
For good example, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Willy Wonka, did not need to be remade. There was nothing about that movie that was lacking when they first made it. Right.
Apparently, they thought it was lacking the dark undertones of Roald Dahl's book.
And we need to know who Willie's dad was. Is that in the book?
I don't know.
Good day.
You know why I didn't read the book? Because I saw the movie with Gene Wilder, and I was full.
All right. I'm full. And you could watch it now, and it's still good.
Absolutely.
So it's still a new movie.
Yeah.
If it's still good and not dated.
Yeah.
One point here in the discussion, because I was reading some critics. I hate the critics. I mean, I'm just like, I'm really like over them. My one thing I read about Hardcore Henry as I was trying to find some information about it, I see this phrase over and over and over, and it needs to stop. While the movie is by no means perfect, I've seen that in like 12 movies recently, and that's how a critic gets away liking something that they maybe feel they shouldn't. Like maybe Hardcore Henry is not the artistic experience that they feel it should be,
right?
Or whatever, because nobody has a disease in it, I guess.
Yeah,
he's
all about Son of Saul.
I mean, that's the only thing they feel like
there are not enough Nazis in this movie.
It's no Son of Saul.
Right, yeah. But meanwhile, it's a film that's much like Mad Max or whatever that's impossible to make. It's so hard to make, you could round it up to you just can't even do it. But, you know, by no means perfect. Perfection is your standard? Really? You went in, you go, well, I sure hope this movie's perfect. I mean, why?
Talk about a man who spends most of his life disappointed.
Right?
I know, right?
Shouldn't you be
no, they're not perfect movie.
Shouldn't you be beating your children for that A-? I mean, come on.
I'm going to go on IMDb.
There we go.
Thank you.
Joke.
That's our cue to get on to the next movie.
And we're on the board again.
That's
on
what? That's two.
Oh, Lord.
That's two jokes. Exciting.
Although I am
double
leading in
chuckles.
Double their
usual total.
I said I am leading in chuckles. You've got more guffaws.
Guffaws.
Murmurs and chuckles.
Good.
I got some chortles.
I'll be performing at chortles this weekend, by the way. Chortles in West Covina.
One show only.
All right, Karen, let's get on to a movie that you're excited about.
I'm very excited about this.
Our next film is from Melissa McCarthy, pretty much the biggest name in comedy right now. McCarthy has had a legendary run of comedy hits, and she also did Tammy. This one's called The Boss. Let's do it.
Dr. Corporate, approve memos, lead a workshop, remember birthdays.
Remember birthdays.
The Boss, starring Melissa McCarthy as Bruce Springsteen. Hey, look, if Kate Blanchett can be Bob Dylan, I'm just...
The Boss, in The Boss, Melissa McCarthy plays Hilarity McConfident.
Oh.
I mean, I didn't have the internet when I wrote...
I think you're right, though.
That sounds about right.
Assuming that's the name.
Wait, here's a good summation. From the director of Tammy and the co-writers of Tammy, the star and producer of Tammy and the guy who ironically played The Boss in that one scene in Tammy comes not Tammy.
Okay, wait a second. All right, here we go. Melissa McCarthy, everybody's favorite... Well, just everybody's favorite, right?
True.
She plays the wealthy head of a major corporation living in the lap of luxury with all her needs catered to and everything she could ever want. Or, as Wall Street calls it, a good start.
That is it. Thank you, Karen.
Mm-hmm. Thank
yes.
you. And she could be considered a titan of industry.
Ooh, which industry?
There's no mention of the industry. Yeah, sorry. In the trailer, they don't do that.
No.
But the important thing is she's a titan, like Vanderbilt or Rockefeller.
Or Starfire.
Or Carnegie.
Or Cyborg.
Okay, Adam, stop it.
What
Guys, go away.
Or
about?
Raven. Sorry, those are teen titans.
Yeah.
McCarthy's business turns Miss Fortune 500 when she bolsters her income by insider trading in the stock market after receiving a hot tip to invest in Ghostbusters sequels when the stock was at an all-time low.
She tries to claw her way back to the 1% by starting a Girl Scout-like cookie empire. She gets the idea when she attends a dandelion troop meeting and realizes there's real money to be made by selling a $2 box of cookies at a 400% markup. 12 cookies for only $8? We're going to be rich!
Is this based on a true story? No. And you can tell because she does jail time for cheating the stock market. Or as Wall Street calls it, Thursday.
After being released from the Martha Stewart tennis prison for insider trading, the movie turns kind of odd couple when her former assistant, played by Kristen Bell, must endure her as a roommate. A relationship that literally leaves the streets littered with fiery wreckage after McCarthy causes a gang war between Girl Scouts. I think that's called comedy heightening.
Mm-hmm. I think that is heightening.
Yeah.
The assistant's name is Claire.
Claire?
Claire. Family name.
Oh, it's a fat girl's name.
And it's played by Kristen Bell, who gained 5 pounds of frump in order to convincingly portray a single mother struggling to find love.
It all sounds like...
Yay, joke!
It all sounds like it could be a Will Ferrell movie premise. Well, that's because you won't be surprised to learn that it is Will Ferrell who's producing this movie, after all.
Oh, news to me.
Yeah.
The supporting cast features a mix of famous comedy and musical performers, including Kristen Schaal, Cecily Strong, Ben Falcone, Dax Shepard, Carrot Top, T-Pain, Michael McDonald.
He came from somewhere.
Not that Michael.
Oh, that would be great.
It's not that Michael McDonald. And also David Banner.
Mr. McGee, don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry.
Not that David Banner.
Bruce Banner.
That's true. Yeah.
That's Bruce Banner.
Well, on the TV show, David.
Yes. Oh, really?
We are technically accurate. You know
now
why?
Now he's shouting out incorrect. Like things we're doing wrong.
Well, hey, we got Ian here to correct.
I've got a bone to pick.
Jesus. Bone picking.
You know why they changed his name from Bruce to David?
Uh-oh,
in 1979? Bruce was considered a gay name.
Well, Bruce Jenner was just winning stuff back
he's
then,
in the wings.
Right?
Nailed it.
They were not far off. They were not far off.
Gentlemen, I ask you, the real question is, do audiences want to see McCarthy whack, smack, and crash away through another two-hour movie? The answer is no.
Oh.
No. That's why The Boss is only 99 minutes long.
Yay.
Enjoy America.
Now, again, I am not one to go on a tangent.
Yeah.
But that Tammy.
Yeah, you're not?
But that Tammy movie was pretty funny.
Was it?
I didn't see it.
It was very well done. It was very tidy, tiny. Yeah. I loved the movie.
You'll be happy to know that, it's Ben directing again. So her husband.
Yeah.
And it's
Ben's directing?
He's directing. He directed Tammy.
Yeah.
He's directing this.
Did I ever tell my Ben Falcone story? Where I ran into him in the grocery store on Halloween Day.
Did you remember what his name was?
Well,
did. Did you point at him and shout a character that he had played?
No.
The way you did with Borat!
You know what? I just want to put a public service announcement out for celebrities. Don't go to the grocery store in L.A.
No. Because if I'm there on Halloween and I run into Ben Falcone, so it's literally like 5 o'clock Halloween afternoon,
yeah,
and we're both in the candy aisle because obviously we've screwed up.
Oh, right.
And we both go to reach for like the last bag of
It's all bubble gum.
And someone else's hand grabs it, and there's a fight. Ah, sorry, that's the movie in my head.
It's the last bag of Reese's peanut butter cups, and he kind of like, he didn't see me because I came around the corner and he kind of cut me off and he reached for it. And then he noticed I was there and he stopped. And I said, oh, look, just because you think you're famous. And he had this look on his face.
Oh, that's horrible.
Like, look, guy, I'm not, and I'm not trying to play that. I said, no, Ben, I'm just kidding. I'm a big fan of yours. And he's like, oh, thank you very much.
Oh, my gosh, you're so mean.
But at least I remembered his name.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, in this instance, I wish you hadn't, poor guy.
And that was at the Vons in Burbank, right there on Pass Avenue.
Oh, yeah. Oh, the man's just
is
trying
the
to
rock and roll Vons.
Candy.
Yeah, you see a lot of Ben Falcone and porn stars there.
Yeah, that's because they have the porn star karaoke. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Sardo's porn star karaoke.
Sunday night.
Yeah.
Calendar events.
All right, who's going to this movie? Oh, yes. I am.
I think we all are.
Well,
America.
It'll come to me.
Yes.
I predict it unseats Batman versus Superman.
Good.
Because that movie's dropping like a rock.
Yeah. Yeah, I read that. I read that in all 12 articles on IO9, who has nothing else to publish.
You know, I was...
Let's crunch those numbers again.
I've seen this trailer now a billion times. And the first time I sort of laughed at the part where she gets sucked up into the hide-a-bed, into the wall... But we've all seen that
That's
before.
That's kind of classic.
Yeah, I almost wish.
Total Paul Blart move.
Chaplin move.
And it's funny because she goes flying all weird, but I almost wish she would have sat on the bed and it would have just pulled away from the wall because we've never seen that. Like the wall just caves in. That would have been fun.
It is funny. Things like that are also aided by digital effects now. I notice pratfalls and things flipping up or throwing people stuff have gotten so much more violent in the digital era. Like, people don't just, like, fall anymore. They get flung against walls. And yeah.
And the sound effects are crazy. Like, the flops and stuff.
An epic adventure can't have, like, an army of 50 versus an army of 60. It's a million guys a million guys. It's all amped up by CGI.
I rewatched a Spy again recently. I mean, this is a modern classic. She's amazing in that first. I mean, I think Paul Feig is like the most amazing comedy filmmaker. That movie, I've watched it now like 3-4 times. It just gets better and better and better.
It pulled a brilliant comedic performance out of Jason Statham.
He's really funny in that movie. Absolutely.
I didn't know he had it in him because he's so the same guy in every movie, running around,
it's
kicking
really
your ass.
Funny.
And then suddenly he's hilarious. Suddenly he's doing this.
I'm a real spy. I once drove a car off a freeway on top of a train while I was on fire. Not the car. I was on fire.
He's starting to freak me out.
So that's, she's great.
I will say, I think you see a little bit of that in Snatch.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, you get a hint that he can be a little quirky.
And he's playing on his action personality as well. And that's the genius thing of it, too, is like they're making a joke about that, and he's willing to joke along with that. He just shows up over and over. The comic beats in Spy are just crazy. It just, I cracked up so much. There's a scene where she finally, like, she's aiding the Russian, who's also genius. What's her name? Russian.
Rose Byrne.
Rose Byrne.
Oh, so funny.
Genius
in that
movie, too. And finally, she shows up, and then Jason Statham's there, and she goes, oh, God. And he holds out his arm all nice, and he goes, walk with me this way. You know, like, he's finally accepted her. He pulls her right around the corner and starts yelling at her again. And they have the funniest conversation in that and just start one-upping each other. And now she's got all her confidence and everything. And she goes on this whole thing. It's like, oh, what did you expect me to come in here? Like, where's Blue Man Group? Like, did you expect me to do all that stuff?
You see that cat shirt they gave her?
Yes. God,
just
all
give
that
her
stuff.
This. Hundreds There's so much... That the jokes are not only just in the writing, but also in the set design, costume design, the wigs they give her. Fantastic stuff.
And so this that's two with Feig, three with Feig, Bridesmaids, right? Mm-hmm. And Heat, and then that. And that was just second with her husband, Ben Falcone. Yeah. The first one was Tammy. And if you don't think of it as one of her biggest hits, you probably think Bridesmaids and Spy, perhaps. That was $20 million, made $100 million worldwide. So that's all you got to do.
Huge.
That's all you got to do to be.
Superman should be so lucky.
Yeah. Exactly.
As you said last
There's
week.
A,
yeah.
a scene in the preview that reminds me of the great scene in the plane from Bridesmaids, where she has her leg way up here and she's tanning. It's just.
In the bus.
In the bus, yeah.
I have a question about her career, though. Because I'm wondering, did she try to make that turn with St. Vincent, or has she yet to make that turn? Because
Serious turn?
Yeah, I'm thinking about Jim Carrey, where for a while he was just the funniest thing on screen. Now it's her. But he made that turn, I think, in Truman Show.
They got to get serious.
Right? So I'm wondering, is she yet to make that turn, or did she try it with St. Vincent and went back to... Because there's a quality about identity thief, spy, boss...
sadness to it.
Well, this is the quality of the production in the movie and the caliber, right? It's not these big, heavy... Yeah. Kind of movies. And I'm just wondering, was St. Vincent her attempt and it didn't quite go off?
I think it was a wise attempt to detour there but not stay there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's like, here's this, and meanwhile, spy and
heat.
The boss. Yeah.
Heat.
I had no problem with her performance in St. Vincent.
She was great.
Yeah.
No, I'm just wondering if it didn't quite take for the world.
No, I think it did, but I think it was wise for her not to stay in that world. You know, come back to comedy away. Maybe
I
Carrie
often have
stayed
wrong
on
opinions.
Is Paul Feig directing Ghostbusters?
Yeah.
Good. All right, cool. All right, good.
Will Ferrell veered towards seriousness a few times.
Oh,
I think
what was that movie where he was hearing voices? Everything Must Go in
Stranger Than Fiction.
Yeah.
And I'm glad he veered right out of that. Because like Jim Carrey, like once he veered there, it was like, dude, don't, like, are you really going for the Oscar? Like, go do one of those and then kind of jump back and forth. But yeah.
It's been tough for him to come back.
Well, not everybody can do the Tom Hanks. Because Tom Hanks can actually go back, right? Yeah. He can go back and be goofy.
Oh, my gosh. If he did a Volunteers 2, you'd be in line. First person right here.
Tom Tuttle from Tacoma, Washington.
All right. I have one more game involving the boss, but we'll play it after our break.
Okay.
All right. That break's just 10 seconds. You know, we're going to take a little more than that, but we'll get our guest in here. So we'll be back in a brief moment with the co-star of the new film Always Worthy and longtime comic actor and Second City alumni, Ian Gomez. So we'll be right back.
Yes! Ian's doing jazz hands, everybody.
We should
or he put the piano on the wall. One or the other.
It'd be so great for the YouTube video if we just had a smoke bomb just go off and they appear.
And they appear. I really want that to happen.
And we are back with our guest from the Drew Carey Show, Cougar Town, and tons more now with a new film called Always Worthy, now available on VOD all over the place. Ian Gomez!
Yay! Me! Me!
Yes!
Me!
But which one do you lead with now? You lead with Cougar Town, right?
That's the most recent big thing that I've been
which
in.
Which one are you prouder of, happier
you
with?
Know, I used to, well, of course, Cougar Town, because they may hire me again.
is it coming back?
Well, you know, all those people. Bill Lawrence works a lot.
Oh, that's a Bill Lawrence.
And he's a good guy. But I loved working on Felicity. That was a lot of fun. Felicity with Kerry Russell.
I was going to say J.J.
Abrams,
and then you end up on Lost. So is there some sort of J.J. camp you get in, and he treats you right? Brings
well,
you back?
Yeah, that was the hope. And when I got Lost, and I also did Heroes, which I think was J.J. Abrams.
No, not at all.
Okay, anyway, Lost. I don't follow. Lost. Yeah. I'm just an actor. I'm really stupid. But with Lost, and you know. I thought I was like in that world, and then it never happened again. Like all the movies, I'm like, yeah, hey, and nothing happens. So,
thanks for bringing that up.
But I do want to talk about the Cougar Town.
Okay,
in my theory, because I never watched it in its early stages. I watched it later on. As soon as you showed up, I was like, I'm in. Boom.
I was in from the beginning, but yeah, whatever. Okay.
As soon as you showed up.
Sure.
As soon as I realized.
As soon as you turned on the TV.
As soon as Bart was on it.
Yeah,
he was
okay.
In.
So nice try.
You were. It was
good attempt.
It wasn't a good attempt.
No,
so you were there
awful.
From the first day?
Yeah.
So
I was
my theory
every
is
single episode.
So is my theory correct? It started off as a little more salacious. It was an hour
long.
It
started off as what it was going to be. It was going to be Cougar Town. It was about Courtney Cox dating. What am I talking too loud?
Okay. No, I had to turn you down because my pink headphones just make everything crazy.
You sound great. It started out as Courtney Cox was going to be dating all these younger guys. And she was going to be a cougar.
Yes.
And then I think that's how they sold it. But in reality, they had this idea that it was going to be like adult friends. It was going to be like a bunch of friends who are just older kind of thing. And that they, like, just her dating a bunch of younger guys was going to be dull after three episodes. So after three episodes, they kind of started changing it where it was just kind of like, you know, the six friends, oddly. And then, you know, we're all just, like, hanging out drinking wine. So, yeah.
The thing I loved about that show were actually two things. One, it does
Ian Gomez.
Three things.
I loved about it.
It does what all really successful sitcoms do, which is create a world that you can buy into and you want to live in. Big Bang Theory does this really well. Cougar Town did it amazing. The other thing that was really well amazing about Cougar Town is you did not have living room with sofa.
Oh.
Every sitcom has living room with sofa.
Yes, there was a living room with a sofa, and we sometimes sat on it, but it wasn't like the central area.
Exactly.
Well, our central area was around the island in the kitchen.
Or the bar, yes.
We had that. But we all had our spots around the island in the kitchen, and the women, the other women, not Courtney Cox, but the other women got to sit down at the island. And if you were like, I think I'm going to sit here for the... No.
Oh.
No. We're around this thing. We're going to have to shoot for hours and get everyone's coverage. I'm sitting down. You're standing up. And it's just like, oh, God. So, you know, I hate to complain that I had to stand up while I was on my fantastic TV show that I was getting paid a ton of money for. But I did. And my arches fell, and I had to get orthotics. And well, it's feel for me.
Well, at least you didn't have to wear heels.
Well, you don't know. I might have been wearing heels. I'm the shortest one in the cast.
I had a defeat.
I had to make my stance.
He didn't have to.
I didn't have
to. He wanted to.
But he did.
He did anyway.
I'm wearing heels right now.
Let's circle back to the movies we covered.
Oh, yeah.
You got any thoughts on them?
On what? Oh, yeah.
Henry, the boss.
The boss. There's one thing in the trailer where, you know, she's playing tennis and she, you know, it's another CGI thing where she smacks the ball in the guy's and Ben's throat, which makes me laugh because I love slapstick comedy. So, and then you were right about the bed folding up. That looks like we've all seen that a bajillion times, and like before there were even talkies. So, you know, and that was like, I think it would have been funny if, like, the wall caved in on her.
No,
you are right, Karen.
Thank you.
Okay. That brings up a good point.
The slap hold.
Melissa McCarthy has undergone some weight loss. Bart, yeah. It was quick to point out. But
I noticed these things.
In writing, yeah. But she still has enough funny pounds where she can Paul Blart herself with the best of them. So this is what I wanted to bring up. Now, we played Paul Blart's sound effect montage from the trailer in the past. I'll just play it one more time for you.
Okay.
This is from Paul Blart 2.
See, Thwarp.
So here's the boss. And though it seems like slapstick heavy, I think it's decidedly less.
Michelle, don't struggle. Son of a bitch.
Wow.
That's a lot of slapstick.
A lot of that is hitting the Girl Scouts.
Right, that is to the song "I'm Gonna Knock You Out," though, right?
Yeah.
That's a perfect slapstick.
Was that
song?
Kid Rock? I couldn't tell what it was.
Well, it was somebody covering
it. That was LL Cool J.
There is nothing.
Mama
that was
said
a cover.
You out.
Yeah.
There's nothing better than seeing one of those smart, sassy, short, haircutted women just punch somebody in the face. I love that.
Got some issues you're working on here.
Oh my gosh, she just smacks that woman.
Well,
in
your
face.
Movie.
Yeah. Melissa McCarthy does that with the best of them.
So
she
funny.
Beats everyone up. You're just
and she's so pretty.
But
and she has that little twinkle. And she's gorgeous, and then she just pops in her face.
Let's not forget, however, the 50 Shades of Black movie which came out in February.
Yeah. This
I'm trying
favorite.
To, Ball. I'm trying.
No.
Ooh.
That just sounds like a car accident.
Doesn't like, sound like a comedy.
Trying
like a Schwarzenegger movie from the 80s or something.
Has anyone seen or watched the Red Band trailer for The Boss?
No,
I
should.
I thought the regular one was funnier. They actually have alternative punchlines for the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, the less vulgar ones actually work better and are funnier.
They shot an airline version?
Clearly.
That's all they shot.
yeah. Or a blockbuster version.
They're promoting her now in the commercials as the greatest rated R comedian of all time or something like that. So they're pitching to get, you know, the folks who like Spy and Bridesmaids and all that to come out.
But the great thing is she makes it so that, like, my aunt would go see this rated R comedy because it's Melissa McCarthy. You know, like, yeah. like if any other rated R comedy.
I liked her in that
comedy,
one with the police guy on TV. Yeah, so, right. So you would watch that. All right, so that's, anyway, speaking of movies that are brand new, Ian is in a film called Always Worthy.
Yeah. Yes, I am. It's available on iTunes.
Yes,
and a bunch of other things.
For a couple
of weeks, mentioned, yeah, you mentioned
Amazon Prime. Yeah. I think you can get it on YouTube.
Yes.
Yeah. And give us the lowdown on what this movie is.
Movie's about a young woman in Hollywood trying to make it, as a lot of young women and men are trying to do. And basically, you know, she's trying too hard. She's just, you know, she's a train wreck. That's another movie.
Yeah.
Movie. Train wreck. And she's, I think it says in the thing where she's just like, the biggest hurdle is getting over herself. And, you know, eventually she does. And she's a wonderful woman. The woman who wrote this and stars in it is Amber Lee Coulson. And she started as a one woman show. And then she wrote the script. I'm not sure which order it came in, but, and she's fantastic. She's,
Wait, let me just jump in with that to play a little bit from the trailer to back that up.
All right.
I am a great actress. There are two kinds of people, believers and dreamers. I'm a believer. Believers make things happen.
You were thinking about improvising a tap dance that they weren't asking for. Did you do it?
Just stop. And that's what I did this morning, is I created my own break.
I'm letting you go.
So...
Oh, it's that movie. Okay, I thought it was a different movie. I'm sorry. Wrong movie. This is really embarrassing.
Actually, there's something really kind of neat about the idea. As a matter of fact, Ian, I believe it's your character that tells her that if you would just get out of your own way, you say something.
Yeah, I play the her best friend's boyfriend, who's a Hollywood agent, and he's really hard on her, and he's kind of like trying to give her, you know, a little bit of a break and like getting her on, see some casting people. And
you're a very powerful agent. You just say, I'm going to get you an audition. And then she's auditioning for a role in a TV show.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, I have that kind of, you know, pull.
Yeah. That's a big deal.
In real life, too.
Okay. So, great to know. Good
to
know.
And so really hard on her and just like, you know, just not listening to her. Doesn't even remember her name, all the stuff. And
like an agent.
Yeah, just like an agent. Yeah,
just like an agent.
Yeah, it's not a it's a completely true portrayal of these guys. They're all
beep.
Yeah, except for mine.
Of course.
Yeah, they're great. I have great representation.
Now, did you become an agent and live in an agent's suit for a month?
Yeah, that's kind of the actor I am. I fully develop myself and envelop myself into the character that I am. No, it's all surface stuff. I really have no idea what I'm doing.
How did you get involved in this? Did you know Amber or did you audition?
No, I got a phone call from my manager, and I guess he represents someone else on the film. And he's like, hey, you got an offer for this. I'm like, yep, I'll take it. He's like, do you want to hear what it is? I'm like, nope, I'm in.
I love it.
To self.
That's the way to be a working actor. Good for you.
Yes, I said yes. And then I was like, oh, wait, maybe I should read this because I may have to be naked.
Ooh.
Let me read this. And I didn't have to be naked.
So,
And then I met everyone involved. And it was like one of these things where it's like no one believes it. It's like everyone involved was fantastic. From, you know, the costumer, Amber Lee, the director, the producers, which are usually like, you know, total tools. These two people were fantastic. Everyone was great. And I was just like, I'll do anything for you. I'll even do the movie guys.
Oh,
and
yay!
They're like, yes.
They must have been nice people.
They were really nice people.
You joke, but
I can't wait to get out of here.
You joke, but that was the deal.
Put it up on the board.
Yep, put it up. There it is. That's five, ladies and gentlemen. Five jokes.
So it was a wonderful experience. It was, you know, it was like a love fest, everything. And it all came from like Amber Lee and the director, Mariana Palka, and they're fantastic people. And just like, it's just, if every job could be like that, it would be wonderful. I've had many jobs, as everyone has, that where it's not like that, where you're like, just like, I'm in a living hell. but I'm getting paid or not, but it's going to advance my career, hopefully, or not. You know, it's just like, well, this is what I do, so I just got to suck it up and do it. But this was actually like a labor of love. That's the 1022 going to Vegas. All right.
But is there an overall statement you can make about big budget versus indie? That is, do you find that the indie people are more?
Well, there's a thing. There's more. It's a labor of love. Everyone's doing it for the love of it, and they believe in the project as opposed to.
Is that how they paid you with love?
Yeah, I'm paying a lot of love.
There's a lot of hugs at the end of this. Yeah, not getting any money.
Yeah. Here's $50 and a hug and some craft service.
From the production company, my grandma.
Box of crackers, yeah.
Yeah, my grandma would like to pinch your cheeks.
And here's an envelope with $5
in it. Yeah, it was a bit. Yeah, I got an envelope. I got an envelope with $50 in it. But it was, it's people want to do it because they do these movies because they want to do these movies. They believe in the movie and they believe in everything. So it's like you feel it and you want to be a part of that. As opposed to, you know, big budget movies and whatever, it's a business thing. Even though they may be wonderful scripts and wonderful people involved, that's more of a business. I mean, the people in the smaller films, they want it to succeed and do great, but you know, it's like, well, you know, we love this thing, so let's get it made. And so it was really sweet.
And also, they know the path to success for like an indie film is like the passion we had to even get this going to begin with. That's what we've got to execute on, is keep that passion going. Whereas,
right,
like
exactly.
A bigger budget
film, you got to keep it up. You got to keep it up like this chair. You got to keep this chair up. Got to keep it going. And So and it's a thing that runs on the constant pushing of the producers, because the money runs out constantly and they have to get, you know, they have to, you know, get more money involved. And so
more hugs,
more hugs,
more hugs,
more hugs, everyone.
Ian, did you find there was any room for improvisation in the script?
There was a little bit, you know, there wasn't really a need for it. Mm-hmm. Everything was written, but they were open to, like, you know, tweaking things here and there. If you had an idea or something like that, Amberly was very cool about that. But there was really no need for it. So, you know, everything was written so well, and it's, you know, it was so easy. You read it and you go, yes, I know exactly who this guy is. So why mess with it?
Beep. Now you're a veteran improviser. You were
yes, I am.
You were Second City ETC and main stager.
Well, I never got it to main stage.
Oh,
okay.
Bring that up, Adam.
Whatever.
Thanks a lot. Whatever. Sorry,
I understudied on main stage.
Understudied
for Chris Farley, actually.
Ah, yeah. Interesting.
But you're on ETC with, I think, Colbert and...
Yes, I got hired with Stephen Colbert and Chris Farley and a bunch of other famous people who are much more famous than I am.
So have you ever been...
Thanks again for bringing that up, Adam.
That's
it's going well.
Yeah. Please.
You're making Adam's my least favorite person, by the way.
You're making my cougar town.
Yes.
Paul look really easy.
I would just like to say, for this whole room, everybody that goes to the Second City ends up at that place with someone who got way more famous than
that's
them.
True. Yeah.
I was going to say, Tina Fey came to my bridal shower.
For example.
So, for example.
Yes.
Ian is a lot more famous than Adam.
Yeah.
There you go.
Tina Fey.
Oh. There you go. That's right.
Adam was there.
Yeah. So I mentioned Always Worthy, where he's the most famous guy, so I look pretty good right now.
But even Stephen Colbert goes, man, the Tina Fey, I wish I could get some of that money.
Yeah.
Have you ever had to fully improvise parts and stuff? Have you ever put that into use, or are you mostly, you know?
Occasionally, like what I was on a show called Felicity.
What?
Yeah,
really?
Felicity. Yeah,
you work with a lot of hot women.
Yeah,
yes,
you
I do.
Do.
So I got to, you know, I got to mess around with some stuff with that. But usually, you know, on TV especially, they're like, you know, say the words I wrote, say them exactly the way I wrote
not
them.
Not a director's
medium. 58 minutes.
Yeah. Right, exactly.
Can't go
stop
yabber
messing up. Around. This is costing me a lot of money. So yeah, so I don't get to improvise that much. You know, usually it's, you know, you'd. At the end of a scene, like when you're done, you get to add a little line here and there, and hopefully it'll make it in, but it never does. They cut before that.
They just tell you, they're like, all right, if you want to just play with this, we won't use it.
We got everything we need. We got everything you need. Here's one for you. You do whatever you want to do, and you do it, and it's like you never see that on the screen.
So Drew Carey, you were on the Drew Carey show. He never threw you a bone, brought you on the Who's Line? And if he didn't, now's your chance to yell at
him. No, you know, he threw, he got me on the show once, and it was probably the worst experience I've ever had in my life.
No.
It's a different sort of improvising. I'm you know, more of the slow, let's create a scene kind of a thing. Let comedy come out of real life. You know, whose line is like funny right away and everyone has to be on it like that. And that's perfectly valid. Yeah. And there are people who are wonderful at that, like those people who are on that show. That was never my thing. Yeah. And it was all basically kind of pre-rehearsed and you're going to improvise this, you know, later on that you improvise, but you're going to improvise it again like it's the first time. And I was like, oh, well.
Really?
Which then it's like second time blues. It's like it never comes out as funny as it was the first time. So that was a terrible experience.
I feel like Ryan Stiles was the show that we saw up in Toronto.
It was the first one you saw.
That's the first one I saw.
Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's wonderful.
He was really
great. Yeah, he's really good.
Now, you're the type of actor that I like to call of stage and screen.
Oh, dear.
Oh, wow.
Where's this going?
Yes.
No, of your, if you had your choice, if you had your druthers, I mean, you've been on long-running sitcoms,
you've
series, and you do movies.
Mm-hmm.
What would you, if I came to you and said, okay, it's going to be one or the other?
Well, you know, I got a kid in private school, so I'm going to do sitcoms.
Yeah.
I'm going to do something that's going to last for 6 to 8 to 12 years and does 24 episodes a season. That
get
would
some
be
residuals
fantastic.
Off that.
Yes.
And you can stay in town. And
yes, right, exactly. Yeah. You go do a movie, and it's like,
is there a big difference in the acting for you?
Well, yeah, I mean, even with, like, you know, single-camera TV shows and sitcoms where it's multi-camera, it's a different style, and you rehearse the same thing over and over and over again on a sitcom multi-camera thing, and it gets less funny, and you start doubting yourself, and then the writers go, this wasn't as funny the first time I heard it, you know, last week, and I've heard it 14 times since then, and for some reason I'm not laughing the same way. Mm. Well, because you've heard it so much. Mm-hmm. So then they change it up on you, so it keeps changing. You're kicking my mic. And then, you know, with single camera, you do it like 3 or 4 times, and you can change it up a little bit, and then they'll make their decision after that, and then, you know, you're done with it. But the schedule for a sitcom is like Mondays are like this, Tuesdays are like this, you get out at this time, you get out at that time, you can schedule a life. And when you're doing single camera, it's like, well, we're going to start at 6:45 a.m. you have to be here at 4, and then you're going to be here until midnight, and your Saturday shot. So you know, it's one of those things, but you know, it's apples and oranges. It's you know, there are benefits of both of them. So I enjoy working, so please
don't let that throw
single
you,
camera people don't please hire me still.
Please continue to give all sorts of jobs.
So no
I am
scrubs.
Killing my own career on this show.
Was Cougartown single camera?
It was single camera, yes.
Oh, okay.
But it was more. I mean, we had more of a multi-camera kind of a schedule because we would do like 3 weeks on and like 1 week off, and the hours were not that long, and you didn't go like Friday night into Saturday morning. And, you know, you have Courtney Cox there, and she's like, well, I'm not doing that. It's like, and, you know, you had a bunch of people who were like, I'm not doing that. I'm like, okay, I'm not doing it too. Well, oh, I am? Oh, everyone else is going home? Okay, great. Okay, then I'll stay here and do it.
Oh, Bart, ask him in your important Courtney Cox question.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Well, what is it?
I have not yet, but have you seen her boobs?
I think I saw them accidentally once.
Those are the best boobs.
Yeah.
Accidental boobs are the best boobs.
Yeah.
Because you're not expecting
it. Yeah, she had a change, and I was boobs. Like there, and there was a curtain, and the curtain was open, and I opened it. So she doesn't know I saw them.
That takes some of the accident
out
of it.
Yeah, I saw it. Yeah.
You accidentally opened them.
I accidentally, purposely opened them. I saw them.
Because she is not ugly, that woman.
No, she's not a beautiful
woman.
Beautiful woman.
Misfits of Science, Courtney Cox.
Pretty girl. Right.
For me.
Dancing in the Dark Springsteen videos.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
Family Ties, Courtney Cox.
Yes. Yes. Good one.
Thank you.
We're old.
So you're coming out of the improv scene, Second City.
Yeah.
What translate? First of all, that's where you met Nia Vardalos.
Yes, I did.
Your
yeah.
Lovely wife.
She was up in Canada.
What is
Canada.
She up to?
Yeah, she's
just
doing
hanging
some,
out,
she's
doing nothing,
doing little indies.
Yeah.
she was in the London, Ontario cast of Second City. She actually has a wonderful story of how she got on the stage. She was working in the box office at Second City in Toronto, and one of the actresses got sick. And they're like, her understudy couldn't be found, And she's like, I know the show. And she went right on and she filled in and, you know, nailed it. And then they put her in the cast. And so she was, and then she was brought down by our producer in Chicago, Joyce Sloan, the late great Joyce Sloan. Yes. And then she was, you know, there, and that's where we met. And, you know, that was a long time ago. We've been married for over 22 years.
Wow, good congratulations.
For you. Yeah.
Congratulations.
I have a question.
Yes, I've seen them.
You've seen her boobs, I'm sure.
I've seen them. Not accidentally.
After 22 years, I hope she shows them
once
clearly.
Or twice.
Yeah. Once or twice. On and his birthday.
I'll tread lightly with this, Mr. Gomez.
Oh, my dear. Well, you're
close enough to punch.
Should we leave the room?
I understand.
We never trust him.
There's a guy in the movie My Big Fat Greek Wedding 1 and 2.
Yes.
Name, the character's name is Ian.
Yes.
And not played by you.
No.
thoughts, feelings?
So the character is based... So the movie's based on our wedding and her family and everything like
and
that.
And you.
And me. Yeah. But I was, you know, the character's completely different.
Family's not as funny as hers.
Well, I mean, there's definite similarities. It was one of those things that was like, you know, I never wanted to play that part, and I was also never offered the part. But it was, you know, it's like, you know, she,
always worthy
she, at the time. At the time, she, you know, she wasn't a name at all, and so they had to get, you know, they had to get a name.
Oh,
and John Corbett was a name, and he was very popular from a couple of shows, and so it was like, you know, it was a no brainer. The fact that he's named Ian, the character is named Ian, is like, you know, that's good enough for me. I got a part in the film. I play I play the best friend.
Oh, okay.
You know, so, you know.
I've just been fascinated by that.
Yeah, I don't have an issue or anything with it or
didn't.
Complex.
No, you don't seem
whatever.
Whatever.
Agitated at all.
Okay, fine.
And as we said when we were
and
talking.
And I've seen John Corbett's boobs.
Oh. No, I am interested in that.
Yeah,
all calm down.
Okay.
He will not stop showing them.
As we said, we were talking about Big Fat Greek Wedding 2, which it came out the same week as Superman Batman, I think.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And we said...
Counter-programming.
Yes,
absolutely. I mean, actually perfect counter-programming, because that's...
Because I went to see that.
Yes.
Yeah,
of course. Yes. Yeah. I know where I was, but you know. But
but did you enjoy it?
Well, we'll get to Karen's review in a second. I think Adam's got some kind of point, though. What do you think?
Hopefully.
My point there was, like, the versus budget, the amount of money that it made, I mean, it must be one of the biggest, versus the budget, must be one of the biggest movies ever. Like Batman, Superman, they made, like, that movie for $300 million. So, yay, it had a $160 million opening weekend. Almost not there at all.
Yeah.
But great thing about like Big Fat Greek Wedding and probably two, I assume, is like versus the budget, it's just like immensely profitable.
Well, the first one was like $5 million and then made, you know, whatever it made. It's
just
like the highest grossing romantic comedy of all time.
Very cool.
And then, you know, the second one was, you know, maybe $12 million and they made like, you know, over $18 million the first weekend. So it's like exceeding the expectations.
Yeah.
Of I'm not even sure of those numbers, but it's doing well.
It's
of course,
I think it's over 40
now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, fantastic.
Keep the budgets low.
Maybe you won't have to work so much anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
And Karen, fur car.
What'd you think?
I loved it. So I went last night, and I was surrounded by women over 40, and we all had a blast. First of all, it was absolutely fun, and I got to tell you, I was so happy when Mark Margolis showed up.
Uh-huh.
Oh
yeah.
My gosh, because I only know him from Breaking Bad as the guy who would ding the little bell.
Oh,
and
he's Ace Ventura's landlord is how right. I know him.
Mr. Chickadance?
Yeah, Mr. Chickadance.
So I think he played a Mexican drug lord in Breaking Bad. Now he's come back for Better Call Saul. But then he plays a Greek brother in this.
Yes.
That man is a chameleon.
Yes, he is. Absolutely.
Did you get to meet him at all?
Yes, I met him. He's very nice. You know his right arm doesn't work?
I had no idea.
Yeah.
Wow.
You know those Morgan Freeman things?
Yeah. Wow. Oh, does he have that too? Yeah.
His left hand doesn't work since a car accident, but you wouldn't know the way they just
That's
shoot
amazing.
Around.
Yeah. Like, and the guy Radar from
Jamie Flash. Right.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Gary
Berghoff.
Berghoff, yeah.
I'm sorry.
He disformed one of his hands. He always had it behind the clipboard.
Never knew.
Yeah, interesting fact. Not really that interesting.
Not interesting enough. Yeah. But going back to the movie, it is a fact.
It is a fact. Yeah.
So, what I liked very much about Big Greek Wedding 2 is that the you know, in the first one, we all watch Tula, her whole relationship with Ian and mm-hmm. what happens there. And in this one, they pay a lot of attention to the mother and father. So I adore that man. What is his name?
Michael Constantine.
Oh, my gosh.
Paulie?
I could just walk Michael Constantine all night. That man is, he steals the movie.
Ooh, yeah.
He's adorable. He plays her father.
Yeah, Paulie. Isn't it Paulie?
No.
From Rocky?
No, from Godfather.
No.
This guy right here.
Yeah, he's from Godfather.
Oh, no, he's not.
Are you kidding me?
He's not in Godfather.
Wasn't he?
He's in Leap of Faith.
Oh, is he Sopranos? I'm mixing up my genres.
I don't know if he plays Sopranos.
Yes, he's an Italian guy.
Yeah, but that doesn't
mean...
No, you're thinking
Paul Sorvino?
Yeah, Paul Sorvino.
That's from
Goodfellas?
Yeah.
This is not Paul Sorvino.
Paul Sorvino is not Michael Constantine.
Yeah, this is Michael Constantine.
Of course not. Carry on.
From Room 222.
Unbelievable. Anyway.
40 years ago.
What I was going to
say... I had the name Paul.
Is Michael and Lainey Kazan, they have the major storyline, and it's so charming. It's crazy. I cried 3 times. I cried when he found out that he was a relation, he was a descendant.
Oh my gosh.
I love that because that's something I would do for my dad.
Descendant.
No, I don't want to give away a plot point.
George Clooney. He's related to George Clooney. Okay. He's a descendant.
You're going to see it, right?
Sure.
Yeah,
does Wonder Woman show
it.
Up in it?
Yes.
I Andrea Martin. Okay, she comes in and completely steals all the movie and then lets other people have parts of the movie back. That woman is fantastic and gorgeous.
Yes,
so beautiful in the movie.
I love Absolutely. Seeing SCTV
She's
people
so
show
good.
Up. They're all still around.
She's
all
so funny.
Doing stuff.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Very funny.
Eugene Levy's doing a show.
I love that Eugene Levy show.
Schitt's Creek.
He does it with his son.
It's called the AM radio.
Yeah. You don't have to bleep it.
S-C-H-I-T-Z.
Mm-hmm. He is actually very good looking in that, and I paid attention to that because, you know, first of all, he has his grooming going on in his eyebrows. He's always his amazing suit. Very handsome. He's a producer. He probably finally said, you know what? If I'm going to spend my own money, I'm going to look handsome. And he looks great.
It's his son's show.
Oh, his son is so funny.
Yeah.
His son is great.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Okay.
All right,
and
so
Nia's very good
times.
In it, too. I didn't talk about Nia, but she was wonderful.
Oh, yeah. Well, she wrote it, too, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she wrote it, yeah.
I love the scene where she finds her old glasses and she has to look out the window.
Yeah.
Aww.
Yeah.
So
you
pretty.
Feel bad for her.
I do feel bad.
Was it cool, speaking for her, is it cool to finally make the sequel and to tell more of the story? And, I mean, you waited an amount of time, which I think was appropriate for the story, because now it gets to be kind of the daughter's story. There's another wedding. If you tried to go off of the success and make another one right away.
Well, that's what's so neat about it is it doesn't become the daughter's wedding, which is how these always go, right?
Right.
They always go, the regular people get married, and then the daughter gets married, like Father of the Bride, and then they have Father of the Bride. But this was awesome because it's a nice twist. It's not the kid getting married.
No.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It was, you know, she got to, here's the thing. The producer, Gary Getzman, who's Tom Hanks's partner in Playtone, she was a producer on this movie, but in the first one, she wasn't a producer, and he brought her in on every aspect of the film. You know, all the post-production stuff, marketing, everything like that. And he gave her an education, an invaluable education, and then the same thing happened on this one. And she was in on everything, I know, all like the music, the soundtrack, the composing, everything, and you know, just that alone was fantastic for her. And you know, she wrote the script and bringing all those characters, and then you know, the first table read was amazing. Then everyone getting together and everyone was so happy to be there.
It's a reunion,
you know. It was a reunion. It was a family reunion.
They act
you know?
Like family. Good Lord,
yeah,
it's amazing.
It was amazing. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience. And
Joey Fatone is fantastic.
Yeah, Joey's great.
He's
Joey's
really
good. Oh man, you know, and she wrote such wonderful stuff for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she gave everyone like something to do in the movie.
The grandma.
Yeah, on the grandma. The grandma, you know, the great grandma.
She's beautiful.
She was fantastic in it.
Yep.
You know, I thought I was amazed by, you know, how wonderful she was, and everyone shows up really well in the film.
Yep.
except for my character.
Well, your character. I mean, what we can't make something out of nothing.
I know.
Poor casting.
But here's the thing.
She asked me. She was writing. She goes, "Okay, you want to be in this film?" I go, "Yeah, I want to be." She goes,
"Wait a minute,
do?"
Back up.
She's just sitting home writing.
You're at the dinner table. Oh, hun, you want to be in this one?
Yeah. She's like, "You want to be in it?" She goes, "I would love it if you are." I'm like, "Yeah, I'll be in it." She goes, "What do you want to do?" And I go, "I want to carry a gun." She goes, "I want to be a cop. I was a school teacher in the first one."
Oh, that's funny.
So she goes, "Okay." And she made me a cop.
Wait.
But that, a couple of keystrokes and, you know, it's done.
You got that offer you want.
Boom. And I'm a cop.
Which is kind of great, though, because whenever you guys all, as the family, came in and strong-armed that Northwestern guy, you had a gun.
Yep.
So there you go.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Rob Riggle, he's
he was so funny.
Everyone's great. Yeah, I loved it. I love doing it.
Now, I saw her making the rounds. She was on Seth Meyers' show talking about how the real-life family is all over that set.
Oh, yeah.
True?
Oh, yeah. They come up, like, in all the group scenes, like, where there's, like, a crowd. You know, there's cousins, mom and dad, sister, brother. Her brother flew in from Australia to be in it. So, like, in the wedding reception scene and in the wedding scene, they're all there. It's there, and it's just like, nope, there, and freeze frame. And Nia was in the editing, so you know she got to choose some things.
Oh, that's cool.
There's like one shot, like clearly of her mom.
Oh.
Her dad plays the chanter in the wedding, who like you know was up there on with the priest, and he gets his own single at some point. I was like, oh, great, he's got a great shot. And who's his agent? I didn't get that kind of camera time.
I cried because I thought that was so clever. I'm glad you brought it up. So. They're getting married, the actual mom and dad. And then in the foreground, they're renewing their vows.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. It was very sweet.
Me.
Yeah.
Now it sounds like you've cried four or five times.
I just cried
you've lived with three. Now it sounds like there were four or
five.
There
were many times.
I cried, too. And I had seen the movie.
That's a wonderful idea.
The first cut I saw. And then I saw the finished product in the theater with a bunch of people. And I cried.
So what's your family like?
Yeah. Oh, my family. Oh, boy.
Are we going to get...
You're not going to get a movie out of that family. You're going to get a police report out of that family. No, my family's fine.
Then I definitely want to see a movie.
No. Exactly. I wish I could get a report. It was something exciting. No, my mom's fantastic. She's a Jewish woman from the Bronx who all of a sudden puts on an accent when she talks about it. She goes, she's going to Italy. She goes, I need... She goes, I'm going back to Italy. I need to see the Sistine Chapel again. What? Where does that voice come from? It's like she
sure thing, Faye Dunaway.
And my father's from Puerto Rico, and he's the least Latino man I've ever met in my life. And you know, God bless him, he's had myriad medical problems. He has one eye now. He hasn't trimmed his nose or ear hair in decades. And he told me recently, he goes, I'm getting this film in my dentures, like I can't get rid of, you know, so I'm just not going to wear them.
What?
I'm just going to be all natural and, you know, it's going to be fine. So he's going to be like a one-eyed, no tooth guy with the ear hair and nose hair in Florida. And it's just like,
I smell sequel.
Yeah. It's just like, okay, Dad. And he's like, you know, hey, they boosted up my antidepressants. And so I'm really happy now. I'm like, yeah, great. That's fantastic. So he's a happy man with no teeth, one eye, and a lot of nose hair.
Caked on.
And God bless him. I love him to death.
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, that's my family.
Wow.
They sound ready for brothers, the big screen.
Yeah, no brothers, no sisters. Only child, the only child, parents. I have a very small family. In our wedding, our actual wedding, I had six people there, and she had 400. I had my mom, my dad, my stepmom, my stepdad, my best man, who they wouldn't let be my best man because he wasn't Greek.
What?
Oh,
and my best
word.
Man's date.
That's
so,
amazing.
Yeah, because you have to be Greek to sign the thing as the best man or whatever. So, yeah, it was, I had six people. And it was, it was a great day. I realized it was not my day.
No,
it's the bride's
not really
day.
About my.
It is the bride's
day. Yeah, it was really the bride's day.
You're a placeholder.
I got to be there, and I had the nicest tux. So,
did you actually get an invitation though? They actually had to send you an invitation.
They make you an offer.
I'm like, oh, yes. Hope you can make it.
They wouldn't let you in without the invitation.
Again, the comedy genius.
Check my ID.
The comedy genius of Nia's writing is the Bandoliers. What is that band called?
Oh, the.
That was brilliant.
Yes.
Oh, shoot.
Bandoliers.
Something with F.
Bandoliers. Not Funkensteins.
The
wedding band?
Funketeers.
Funketeers. Joey Fatone's character got a deal on some tuxes.
Yes, he got some tuxes.
And they all say fucking cheers on the deck. It's brilliant because they walk down the aisle and they're sparkly and it says words on
yes.
their back.
Gold lame riding fabulous. On black tuxes. Funketeers.
Love that. Love Funk, the details.
F-U-N-K.
Yes. Funketeers.
Now, the last time we saw Nia was at a book signing for her book Instant Mom, all yes. about and becoming a mother by through adoption.
Yes. So you are an instant dad.
Yeah. So.
Yes. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that was a phenomenal experience. That's why I don't do radio or voiceovers. We just kind of, you know, we went through the whole process of becoming foster parents, and then we got a call and say, hey, we got someone, and she'll be over tomorrow.
Yeah.
And so
I hope you're
it
ready
was,
for that
yeah.
huge responsibility.
Well, you went through
like, we had to child-proof everything and just like, you know. And
did
was,
you let them know that you were open to that, or did you accidentally
well, we
sign
were on,
something?
No, we were on, we had met her, and you know, we met her once, and then it was just like, we're waiting. And then it's like, okay, she's going to be over tomorrow.
Oh, wow.
And 14
wow.
hours later, she was there.
Wow.
And then forever. And she
crazy.
Hasn't left.
You leave the door open, she doesn't get the hint.
Yeah. So,
no, she knows to stay. She's,
great,
she's
no.
pretty smart.
So it's
she
fantastic.
Showed up with like 100 of her family members. Well, it's my family. I'm bored. I can't get...
Yeah, it was fantastic. We had no clue what we were doing. And you learn by mistakes, and wow. yeah, we made a lot. But,
the book details all that quite
and
well.
Do you have just the one child?
Just the one. And we have a canine children.
Oh,
okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, as do we.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Ours has one eye, but he still wears his teeth. So
and not as much nose hair.
Yeah, he trims that, so we're good.
You know, I felt very close to him when I met him, and now
yeah,
I know
that
why.
Was why.
Yeah. Yeah. That's fantastic.
I want to go back to something now.
Uh-oh.
Now the
Uh-oh.
Circle is complete here on the movie
yes,
showcast because we had Eddie Jemison on the show.
Oh yeah,
last mm-hmm. year.
Yep.
The great Eddie Jemison, and he was in one of my favorite commercials of all time. Turns out he's in that commercial. With the great Ian Gomez.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. I would like to play a little bit of it now.
Oh, my
The guy
goodness.
Who goes up to those people wearing or holding signs at the airport. Ian is that guy. And
the chauffeurs.
Is the traveler yeah. mm-hmm. who just wants to be in the limo no matter what name he has to fake to be in.
Driver, do you have any Bud Light in your vehicle?
Yes.
Then I am Mr. Galiwikich.
You mean Dr. Galakowicz?
Yes, I am. This is so cool.
First time in a limo, doctor?
In a limo this small.
If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down, make it a Bud Light.
Make it a Bud Light.
And then he had like
I would drop that commercial like I would try to get into a club and
oh,
I go,
no.
Have you seen that Bud Light commercial with the limo drivers? They're like, yeah. I'm that guy. Oh yeah, come on in. Rope opened.
Sweet.
Yeah, that was a long time ago.
So funny.
Yes,
I'm not proud of that. I don't think I've ever told anyone that.
That's awesome.
What'd you put in that beer?
I quote that to this day for however many years
it's so
old it
funny.
Is. My brother and I, the first time I ever flew, ever in my life, I landed at the airport. It was in my 20s. I hadn't flown since then. Very sheltered life in upstate New York. And my brother was holding a Dr. Galakowicz sign. We have Bud Light with his two daughters waiting at the airport.
And it's for crazy. Anybody in the audience who's me and doesn't know who Eddie Jemison is, he was the guy that Thomas Jane tortures in The Punisher.
Also in Ocean's 11.
Yeah.
But for and Adam, Waitress.
That
he was in Waitress.
For guys who are me in the audience.
Is that right?
Where he has the, do you remember that? Where
which one? The yeah, Jane, Thomas Jane?
Well, yeah, Thomas Jane. And he lights the, Eddie Jemison is he's an informant of some sort. He has him tied up. And he lights a blowtorch and he goes, he goes, when you get burned, it actually feels cold. And then he takes a popsicle and sticks it against his back and he starts screaming. He goes, I'll tell you anything you want.
That's hysterical.
Yeah, it's pretty hilarious.
Oh my God.
You have any desire to be in a superhero movie? Or maybe you were. I didn't look at your whole
I don't know.
Are you a superhero?
I'm going to cast you.
You are wearing your underwear on the outside.
I know. I don't know. There's a lot of fake acting in that. You know, you have to act to nothing. I don't know if I can do that because I'm not that good of an actor. Yeah. I need to actually like look at somebody and do stuff. I can't like, you know,
You know what? I think Ian has a really good like point. Because we all talk about what a great actress Meryl Streep is, right? But when's the last time she just acted with a green screen?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
That's a skill.
Actually, August Osage County was all computer.
Oh, that was all computer?
She was the only actor on the
so
set.
So even Julia Roberts was a computer generated. Yeah,
not there.
Oh, okay.
Shot her part in her home.
Right.
She
doesn't leave the house for anything. Yeah, Iron Lady did all that crap from home.
Weta Digital makes an incredible Julia Roberts. Just lifelike. You wouldn't even know. That's actually Andy Serkis.
It is Andy Serkis.
Wow. He's wonderful.
He's great, right?
He's
great.
Yes.
Let me ask you what we ask every guest who comes on our show.
Hear.
What is your favorite movie of all time?
Okay. I have two. And they're both comedies. One is My Favorite Year, the original with
Peter O'Toole.
That's the okay. The other one's The In-Laws, the original Peter Falk and Alan Arkin.
Genius.
You know, those are my two. If I had to pick like a drama, I would say Apocalypse Now. Which you don't have a poster.
I'll take The In-Laws.
Yeah.
I'll take The In-Laws.
In-Laws. I love that movie.
Peter Falk.
Oh my goodness. The two of them together, it's comic oil and water, and it's so perfect together.
Yeah. I have to write that down because I have not seen that
movie.
Karen
has a growing list on the show.
I write it down, then I'll report back. I'll let you know how I like it. Tweet yours.
Shell, it's cut and dried. It's not cut, it's not dried.
The In-Laws.
Albert Brooks is one of my favorite comedians of all time, but that sequel or the remake just isn't.
I never saw the remake because I didn't want to be upset. Yeah, so I didn't see
There's
it.
There's a remake of The In-Laws?
Yeah. With Michael Douglas.
Oh, so I want the original.
Ryan Reynolds.
The kid.
Really? Okay, yes, so which one do I want with?
You want with Peter Falk and Alan Arkin.
Oh, I love
anything
Alan
with
Arkin.
Either of them really is pretty
Alan
good.
Alan Arkin's Second City too, right?
Yes, yeah? He is. Yeah.
Andrew Bergman is the guy behind that movie, I think, the writer-director. And he went on to, I think, co-write Fletch, perhaps.
Yeah, he did.
The Freshman. He's made a lot of funny stuff.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And then what was the first one? Oh, My Favorite Year.
My Favorite Year with Lainey Kazan. Lainey Kazan was in that movie. Peter O'Toole is the star. Now, it's great.
And that's written by, that's a Neil Simon movie, right?
It's basically, it's based on, I think, like, you know, the Sid Caesar, the Sid Caesar show of shows. That kind of, you know, left around the third floor.
Yeah, this very famous writing crew, which went on to form the comedy of the late 50s, early 60s.
Right, like
really.
Woody Allen was in that thing. Yeah. But yeah, it was based on those people. Yeah. So like, I guess the main character, I forgot his name. I guess we could look it up, whatever. But I guess he was like the Woody Allen character. You okay?
Do you do a Peter O'Toole?
Sorry about that. I'm getting very emotional.
I do not do a Peter O'Toole. Okay. I can't do voices. Except Al.
Yeah, Alan Arkin.
Yeah, well, I did that one thing.
That's a great impression.
Just, it's not good. It's not dried. But that's all I can do.
All right, listen. Karen, let's wrap up.
What?
Use your voice.
I'm ready. Yes. I just was crying so much yesterday that it's hard for me to get it back together.
Gotcha.
I'm good now.
I want you to wrap up things for us.
Because
with
the end of Superman versus Batman.
Yeah, it really upsets me.
Karen's birthdays here with her weekly look, the birthdays of those who make the movies. Take it away.
All right. All right, let's start by wishing a very happy birthday to Mr. Paul Rudd.
Paul Rudd, I love Paul Rudd.
He turns 47.
Adam loves Paul Rudd.
He can play anywhere from Loki to sardonic.
Loki? No, I think that's
Tom Hiddleston. No, it's Ant-Man. Did you know that his nickname is Fred?
Did not.
I didn't know.
Fred Rudd?
Isn't that a great name. Really interesting? I thought that'd be a great name. I had a dog named Fred.
How's that a nickname? That's just another name.
It's another name, right?
I'm not sure. You're not breaking the name down. Or
it's the same amount of letters.
He has another name, apparently. It's called Fred.
Fred. Yeah. So his other name is Fred.
I have a Paul Rudd story.
What is it?
Paul, you got me into the premiere of...
Evan Almighty.
And which back when they did the premiere, what was that theater that's torn down now?
Yeah, the Gibson Amphitheater. Now it's Hogwarts.
Jesus,
which
crazy.
Just opened yesterday.
Yesterday,
with the press event, opens tomorrow, and by the time this airs, it'll be open. And it was quite an event. But anyway, rest in peace, where the Blues Brothers played.
You know, and Steve Martin. And
Well, we exited that, and just because whether you're a celebrity or not, you have to go to the parking lot through the long, you know, walk down the thing there, the Universal
City
Walk.
Yeah, there's like a corridor. I can't even say it.
Corridor?
Yeah.
Corridor.
Not corduroy.
Well, that's where they get the word corridor, right? They're little stripes. They're little tunnels. So I walked next to Paul Rudd. I've been a Paul Rudd fan for a long time. I mean, I just, ever since Wet Hot American Summer.
Yep, that's one of his
that
first.
That scene where he throws his tray down and then Janine Garofalo berates him, like, pick that up. And just that long, like, way of, like, everything he did, I just thought, I mean, there's so many genius things. And then, of course, he continued being in. So I had a huge crush on him, and I'm like arm to arm the whole time, and he can't get away. And I'm just like, oh my God, Paul Rudd's right there the whole time. It was great.
Did you say anything to him?
No, I don't do that.
You're not like this one over here.
Yeah.
Yeah, no,
I
should.
Points and says their name.
You
owe me something.
You're a thing I know.
Well, I was going to say,
you're a noun. You're a noun.
Let's go around the table. My favorite Paul Rudd movie is Role Models. Absolutely cannot handle how happy it made me when they come out as Kiss. To do what is that, the role playing thing that they're doing?
Oh yeah,
LARPing.
Yeah, LARPing.
Oh my gosh, I love that Paul Rudd. Anybody?
This is a trick question.
Why?
I do not have a favorite Paul Rudd.
You do too.
Oh, come on.
40-year-old virgin.
40-year-old virgin.
Anchorman.
Few Good Men. He wasn't in that,
come
right?
On.
Anchorman's the best.
Sex Panther.
Ian, do you
60%
have a
of the time
Paul Rudd?
What's the one with the thing? The guy who has the friend and he doesn't. They do the Rush stuff, the Rush music.
I love you, man.
I love you, man.
Slap into bass.
Yeah, I love that.
That's a good one.
Adam, do the comedies beat Ant-Man or is it Ant-Man for you?
No, Anchorman still is. Like, that's just one of my.
That's funny.
Love comedy almost as much as I love superhero movies, and like that, Anchorman is just. Perfect, absolutely perfect. All those characters, and especially his.
Yeah, I'm with you, honey, on Role Models.
Brian Fantana.
Loved it. You know, he has Captain America Civil War coming out. It's going to be Ant-Man in that.
Great.
That's going to be in May. Fantastic. And he's super busy. Check this out. So this year alone, he's doing An Ideal Home with Steve Coogan, who I absolutely love. That's coming out this year.
Great.
Nerdland, which is coming out April 14th, so very soon.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. And Sausage Party, which is coming out in August.
Finally coming out.
And then The Fundamentals of Caring in June.
For those of you who don't know, Sausage Party, the filthy CGI animated
movie. It's a cartoon.
About food in your kitchen, facing life and death and love.
And
Seth Rogen, Paul Rudd, the whole gang. David Krumholtz was in here talking about making it.
Oh, that's right.
Like a year and a half ago. I mean,
David Krumholtz does the best Alan Arkin imitation.
Oh, yeah?
We'll
get him back in here.
Classic. Yeah.
Now, Adam, did you know that Ant-Man has his own movie, Ant-Man and the Wasp? It's coming out in 2018.
I certainly
do. Well, I don't think it's... I mean, it's Ant-Man and the Wasp.
And the Wasp. It's not
really
just his movie. That's true.
Movie.
Thanks, Ian. Good thing you're here to keep me honest. Well,
It's so exciting.
I lied to everyone.
I'm lying.
Go off the rails with your made-up movies, honey.
I wanted to share this with you because I thought this was kind of cool. So in that scene in 40-Year-Old Virgin where Steve Carell is getting his waxing done and he yells out the whole thing about Kelly Clarkson, that was actually Paul Rudd's idea. He came up with it. Can we hear a little of that, Paul?
Oh,
he didn't pull it for us.
I didn't pull it.
So the answer is no.
No, we all know how that goes.
So we'll drop it in right now, and then we'll just
react. What do we give it?
No, Kelly Clarkson!
That was hilarious.
Wow. And the scene in
I remember that.
The scene in The 40-Year-Old Virgin when he's doing the whole, how do you know I know that you're gay, that whole thing?
Yeah.
You know how I know you're gay? All improvised. So if you're not a huge Paul Rudd fan, know that he's not just saying what other people tell him to say. He's improvising funny stuff.
Go online and find an extra scene from Knocked Up where they're driving to Vegas and they just improvise a whole bunch more of that they didn't put in the movie.
Oh, really?
Also hilarious. Yeah.
And also, I want to wish a very happy birthday to Bud Cort, who turned 68.
Wow.
I was about to say Henry and June. Wrong one.
Harold and Maude.
Harold and Maude. Thank you.
Melvin and Howard.
Play anywhere
Ant-Man
from...
Ant-Man and the Wasp? No.
No. This is different. This is his own movie. Well, no, it's him and Maude. Ah, son of a...
Yeah.
He weirdly can play anywhere from a soft-spoken strange man to a...
Soft-spoken strange man.
To a strange man who's soft-spoken.
Yeah.
Sorry.
But no, it's true. And matter of fact, he used to perform with a band called Bud Cort and the Medflies that occasionally performed on the Sunset Strip at the Roxy.
Who knew?
Paul will agree with me. One of the best jokes in Arrested Development history
yes.
is after an entire episode where Judge Reinhold of Beverly Hills Cop is given his own judge show, Judge oh. Reinhold. That show, at the very end, is replaced by another celebrity judge, Bud Cort. And that's how smart that show is if you're not watching it.
I disrupted a plane when that came across on my TV. Oh, my God.
The reason I wanted to bring him up also Bud is because... You guys are stupid. I think that's kind of cool. He studied with Del Close at Second City.
Did he really?
I did not know that.
Yes, Bud I Cort, found that huh? interesting. Because, you know, he's not... I think that his a lot of his acting clearly is grounded in reality, much like you were saying yours isn't so much like going for the joke. Bud Cort, I would say, definitely does not push for the joke. And I could see where that would be encouraged by Del.
Very understated.
Understated sure. and real. I have a list of movies here, and I want you to tell me whether or not Bud Cort was in this movie. All right. Now, I'm going to start easy. The Life Aquatic with Bill Murray and Cate Blanchett.
Yes.
Yes, he was. Very good. You wouldn't think so, but yes, he was. How about MASH?
Ooh.
Oh.
The original?
The or movie. The series.
No. I'm going to say he is.
He
because
is.
Because it's a Robert Altman movie, yeah. and he is the lead in, God, what is the... The Shelley Duvall movie. Anyway, the Robert Altman's Nashville? Movie he did before that.
No,
it's the Robert Altman movie he did before MASH. Anyway, so yes.
Yes, and that's, he actually saw, Robert Altman saw him doing improvisational comedy in New York City and then asked him to come and work with him on that movie.
Oh.
So good job.
Now, I'm playing this game at a slight disadvantage because every time the name Bud Cort is said, I'm envisioning Bud Collins from tennis fame.
Are you thinking...
Wow. Yeah. So I'm just
you know what?
Can you handicap the game for me?
I have no problem believing that because earlier he thought that the gentleman from Greek Wedding was Paulie.
Paul Sorvino. Paul Michael Sorvino. Custer. Same guy, yeah. right? I mean, they got the same name.
All right. How about Coyote Ugly?
Nobody was in that movie.
I actually auditioned for that movie in Chicago. Isn't that crazy? Yeah.
No.
Coyote Ugly. He was. He was in Coyote Ugly. I know that's super crazy. Dogma?
Yes.
He was in Dogma.
He plays God.
There you go. I thought that what's your name played?
Or not God. He God. Plays some sort of conduit. He's in a hospital. He gets beat up by a hockey gang. And then.
I love hockey gangs.
Yeah. Oh,
all right.
Yeah,
what's
a
your
roving
face
hockey
God.
Gang.
But I'm a cheerleader.
Alanis Morissette plays.
Alanis Morissette.
Yeah, Alanis Morissette does.
But I'm a cheerleader. Was he in that?
Ooh. Oh, But I'm a Cheerleader is the name of a movie?
Yeah.
But I'm a Cheerleader.
With Natasha Lyonne? Is that who's in that?
He was in that.
He was?
I'm just giving you all movies he was in because it's so wacky that he was in these movies.
I'm just sitting here waiting for you to say Invaders from Mars because it's the only one I know.
I was waiting for Dogma.
Hey, Bart, you know how much I love it when celebrities sing?
This is true. Ian, I don't know if this happens to you a lot, but people are constantly coming up to me and saying, can you tell me two interesting things about that Karen Volpe?
Weird.
That doesn't happen to you?
Yeah, that happens to me a lot. Hey, I just realized, you know, I went to high school with a girl named Karen Volpe.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That's crazy. I've never heard my name before ever.
I know.
Well, the two things I tell him is, first
excellent.
Of all, since high school, she has not trimmed her nose hairs.
No, I like to grow them out nice and long.
And two.
I thought it was a mustache.
I am Italian.
It is now. That's not how it started. And two, she loves when celebrities sing.
And
oh,
I do.
Yeah,
I just love it. I go
see,
and I scour the internet. So I decided to bring you a little of a little Cat Stevens from Harold and Maude.
Mohammed, what's his name now?
Yusef Islam.
Muhammad Ali.
If you want to sing out, sing out. But being sung a cappella by the great Bud Cort. Oh.
This was at a screening,
actually,
I believe, right?
Actually, quite adorable.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And if you want to say yes, say yes. And if you want to say no, say no.
He's probably about 60 at this point.
How old is he now?
He is 68.
Wow.
It was earlier this millennium.
What a soundtrack for that movie.
Oh, absolutely.
God.
Yeah. Well, that wraps into the movie showcast, everybody.
Uh-oh.
Together, we're the movie guys. Individually, we are.
Caramel.
Bart guys.
Follow us on Twitter at The Movie Guys and Facebook.com/The Movie Guys, iTunes, Instagram, LinkedIn, Google+, whatever. We're there. And thank you once again to all of our new listeners on WRFA 107.9 in Jamestown, New York. And please come back every Monday at 8 p.m. And thanks to Ian Gomez. Yay.
Very well. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Are you on social? Where can people find you?
Yeah, I'm, my goodness. I think it's IB Gomez on Instagram. And probably Ian B. Gomez. I don't know. Look me up. Yeah. But
the kids are done with IB Gomez.
IB Gomez. IB Gomez on Instagram. You guys validate?
Yeah, yeah, we can validate that for you. Okay.
Thanks to Steve good Schultz as well for his writing contributions to Show Every Week. And as ever, we owe everything to Pat Peach. And remember, you can always find everything we're up to at themovieguys.net. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of...
New Bill Murray movie!
There you go. So you Karen's excited. Bill Murray voices Baloo in The Jungle Book, as we mentioned. Plus new films from Ice Cube and Kevin Costner. So like this week, something for everybody. We'll see you then.
Woo-hoo. I'm not going to be talking about Jungle Book next week, am I? I'm going to get Costner, though, right?
Yeah.